a joyous way to begin worship this morning on November 15th, 2020. Welcome to worship here at the First Reformed Church in Schenectady, whether you are here in person or worshiping with us online, whether you are here at 10 in the morning today or at some time later this afternoon or even in the future. We are glad that you are here to worship God with us. Those of you who are here, we thank you so much for letting us know ahead of time that you were planning to be here. We have been working hard to evolve the policies in these COVID times. We want to thank the task force that presented to the consistory on Tuesday some adapted and new guidelines, a little stricter probably than we have been used to, and we thank them for that hard work. As we remind you that we wear masks always when we are in the building, unless we are speaking or in certain offices. And I want to make you aware today, those of you who are here, that the ushers will be helping to dismiss you so that we distance enough from one another. We will be leaving today through the courtyard door. I think you can expect that next week we probably will be coming in through the main office doors, but please pay attention to our correspondence from the office and online about that. Thank you to John Norton, who played the prelude this morning, and to Kate Rose, who will be singing on our behalf from behind a mask. And we thank Kate for being the first singer to take on that burden. And we thank Max as well for his music today and every Sunday. We welcome you to join us at a virtual coffee hour on Zoom. You can find the link on the website. Come and stay as long as you can. Leave when you need to. But perhaps if you have time and inclination, you can join us for the first forum, which will follow at 11:30. This morning, the forum welcomes Bill Buell, the county historian, who will speak with us about the 100th anniversary of women's suffrage and how that played out here in Schenectady. This afternoon, you can find a concert at 3 o'clock in the afternoon online, and then tonight, you can either come in person or join in the Jazz Vespers online at 5 o'clock. And I would make you aware this Sunday that next Sunday, Jazz Vespers will be from 4 until 6. This will be the annual Thanksgiving Jazz Vespers service, which is a fundraiser for them. There's a suggested donation of $10 a person, and we hope that you will be able to join in that in some way. On Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock, either in person or in Polling Chapel, you are welcome to join in centering prayer, which Daniel will lead. And I remind you that we continue to welcome your pledges to the annual financial campaign this year, either in the mail, or you can bring them to the office, or you can make that pledge easily online, and we welcome your generosity for the coming year. This is your chance to influence the ministry that First Church is able to do, and we trust that you will give generously to support that.
So, Lynn, if I have a pledge, which Mary gave me to put somewhere, I could put it in one of the boxes that are out
I would
there?
Encourage you to put it in one of the boxes.
One of the boxes in the atrium out there?
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Thank you.
That would be great. That would be great.
Good.
Lastly, I want to thank the Chancel Guild and especially Gay Doolittle for the beautiful Thanksgiving decorations that we have to grace our sanctuary this morning. So, Daniel, as we prepare to worship today, what should we focus on?
So this morning, we are going to be considering the words of the Apostle Paul some of the early Christians, and what those words, what the kind of tenor of what it would mean to be engaged in essential mutual ministry would look like in our day, as well as perhaps what it looked like in his. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us worship God.
We greet our worship by greeting our sure Redeemer. Redemption is to be made new. It means letting go of all the things which hold us back. It means trusting that we are held just as we are in God's loving hands, and that we trust that we can become who God calls us to be because of God's generous grace. Let us join together in our prayer of our need for God. Our sure Redeemer, we have sinned against you and one another in thought, word, and deed, in what we have done and in what we have left undone. O gracious God, in your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Sisters and brothers, God is merciful and gracious to us as individuals and to us as community. Let us leave our burdens and take God's hand. Let us be led in love, united by mercy, to be the people of God's heart. Let us hum along together the tune of O God, our help in ages past. Let us join together in affirmation of faith with this piece of our song of hope. The Holy Spirit builds one church, united in one Lord and one hope, with one ministry around one table. The Spirit calls all believers in Jesus to respond in worship together, to accept all the gifts from the Spirit, to learn from each other's traditions, to make unity visible on earth. Come, Lord Jesus, we are open to your Spirit. We await your full presence. Our world finds rest in you alone.
It is in Jesus that we know the peace that he extends to all those who call upon him. We shared together that piece last week with some American Sign Language. We're going to do so again this week. We're going to remind ourselves how that goes. And you got to pay attention, because last week we did it a little differently. This week we're going to do it as we usually say it. The peace of Christ be with you. And here's how it will go. So you raise your hands, and as we say these words, masked, but with our bodies as well, we are living into what Jesus calls us to extend to one another. So we say, as we start out here, the peace of Christ be with you. And then the fun part, and also with you. Let us do so again together. I'm going to share this sign of Christ's peace, and then you get to do the fun part, and then you're going to turn to one another and extend the peace of Christ. The peace of Christ be with you. You can say it as well as sign it. Extend and share Christ's peace with one another now.
The peace of Christ be with you. The peace of Christ be with you.
You may be seated. I hope the children were out there extending and sharing with one another Christ's peace. It's such a wonderful thing to be able to embody the words that we speak and the intentions that we have for one another. And if the children weren't there with us then, I invite you to come around now, wherever you are at home, I trust, or maybe out and about watching on a phone or a tablet or a computer or maybe a TV. I want to share with you a little bit of what we just shared with one another, Christ's peace. You may have noticed that the word for Christ, or the sign for Christ, is hands like this, and then we touch a finger to one palm, and then we touch a finger to the other palm. That is a reminder to us of the love of God shown in Jesus' life. That Jesus loved us so much that he died for us. He was crucified. And so when we have our hands open and then touch the palms, we remember his death on a cross. And also this, we remember that when he rose from the dead, he invited Thomas, one of his disciples, one of his friends, to put his finger in the holes in his hands. So in this way, we remember Jesus crucified and risen. That is some good news that we share with one another this day and all our days. So, the peace of Christ be with you. Amen. You may go and do whatever else it was you were doing this morning before you joined us here, or you're welcome to stick around if you want. This morning we hear Psalm 123. It is a psalm that probably was originated as one of the psalms that was sung as people would go to the temple to worship God. It was a song that, psalm that was perhaps voiced by a leader and then by the people, which is why there's a shift in the speaker's voice from first person singular to first person plural. It is a psalm that expresses the deep longing of the people of God to be released from the contempt of the proud. It is a psalm that suggests that perhaps the psalmist hoped to become so attuned to God's presence and communication that the psalmist could read the hand signals of God, the sign language of God, if you will. Our passage from 1 Thessalonians today is perhaps the earliest writing in the entire New Testament. It was the letter that Paul wrote to a young church that he helped establish. And he, in this letter, which is a long letter of encouragement, in this part of the letter, he speaks to the Thessalonians in their concern about the times and the seasons. He speaks to them about the hope that they have in Jesus Christ, in God, the Creator of all, and in the Holy Spirit's gifts among them. Listen for the word of the Lord.
Psalm 123. To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. As the eyes of servants look to the hand of their master, as the eyes of a maid to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God until he has mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy upon us. For we have had more than enough of contempt. Our soul has had more than its fill of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud.
And these words from Paul's letter. Now, concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night, when they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them. As labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then, let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. As Paul's first letter, as the earliest New Testament writing, I find it interesting that this letter is so overwhelmingly affirmative of Paul's hearers. He writes to these Thessalonians, "You are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness." This is a familiar refrain in this letter to the Thessalonians. In the reading of this letter, if you read it fully through this first letter to the Thessalonians, Paul has no reservations about their life at all. It is, in the word common parlance, all good. It is all good. Paul is completely delighted with the Thessalonians. There's not one warning, not one admonishment, not one complaint that he has about these Christian sisters and brothers. Now let's the first writing, first letter of Paul to the Thessalonians. If you read the second letter to the Thessalonians, it changes some. They've lived a little bit longer. They've struggled a little bit more. They've disagreed with Paul, and some of them have gone their own way or become arrogant or begin to doubt Paul's authenticity. In that second letter to the Thessalonians, Paul is a little bit more nuanced. They're still children of light, but some of them seem to be walking in the darkness or are in danger of doing so. Paul's first letter, however, is just so full of joy and delight and encouragement and affirmation. I think it's important to hear that. It's important to hear Paul's huge affirmation of these Christians, whom were some of the first to respond to the gospel. The letter takes up a concern that is not honestly very much on the minds of many in this congregation, as I know you all. Having been here for 15 or so years, I've never had any of you come to me and say, "Daniel, when is Jesus coming back again? I need to know that. What's the day? What season are we in? Is the day of the Lord near? Am I in danger of damnation?" I've never had any of you come and ask me those questions. And I'm kind of relieved that you haven't. That sort of anxiety is very much, however, in the minds of those Thessalonians. It was in the mind of many who thought that the return of Jesus was imminent. It was going to happen, well, who knows, maybe next week, maybe tomorrow, maybe in a few years, but it was going to happen in their lifetimes. We've lived now 2 millennia, and it's just sort of faded from the minds of many mainline church folk. We understand that that eventually God will bring the consummation of all things, but we don't spend a lot of time imagining exactly when it'll be or feeling anxious about it. Nevertheless, Paul's words are apropos here for us, because it's always fitting to be alert. It's always fitting not to be drunk with wine. It's always fitting to be mindful of who we are and who God is. So my interest here today is to unpack just the very last verse of this passage. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other as indeed you are doing. I feel like this passage, this verse, really fits our context. As I first read through this passage, I made a little note to myself, First Reformed Church is really about this right now. And you've heard me preach many sermons calling you to action, calling you out of slumber, out into the streets for the betterment of the world, calling you to wake up and to be engaged in new ways, in deeper ways, in more self-giving ways. Well, that's not this sermon. This sermon is about encouraging you in doing what you already are doing, and maybe helping you recognize what, in fact, you are doing to be a blessing to one another and beyond one another to the world in which we live. Paul has two words here, and I want to take them, go with a little depth on them. The first is the word encourage one another. It is this word, parakalete, in Greek. Parakalete. It's a word that may sound a little familiar if you grew up reading a translation of Scripture where Jesus says, I am going away, but I will ask my Father to send you an advocate, which is the word for paraclete. Paraclete. The word for paraclete is translated in our version as encourage, be an encourager. But the semantic range of it is much wider. The semantic range would include advocate, encourager. Sometimes it's translated as comforter, and support or help. So this word, encourage one another, has this great breadth, and I don't think we can necessarily say it's just this one thing. It's a fascinating word. I believe, I was told, that encourage comes from the French, cœur, meaning heart. Do I have that right, Heather? I'm looking at Heather and Andy, who lived in France. Yep, cœur, heart. It is with heart. When we encourage, we bring our heart to another. We are with them, with our heart. It is, if you will, all those senses are about helping, about assisting, about enabling, about advocating. It's an intervention. We are encouraging when people are discouraged. We are advocating when people are in danger. We are supporting when people are weak. We are comforting when people are grieving. Encourage one another. The second is different from the first. It's easy to lump them together when we hear just encourage one another and build each other up, like, oh, they're just synonyms that Paul is sort of heaping it on. But you may remember in the ancient world, you didn't waste a word because the paper you got didn't come from Staples. It was papyrus, and it took a lot of energy and cost to make it. So the second word that Paul uses is build up each other. Build up each other. The sense is the word actually is, the origin is about a house. It's oikodomete, oikos, the earth, the ecumenical, all of it. Paul is saying, build up each other, help fortify, establish the foundations, the boundaries, insulate well. Make sure that the framing is appropriate to the conditions. The sense here, instead of an intervention, like encourage one another, the sense here is it's really about constructive, about shaping, giving a sense for the actual well-being of others. It's not interceding, but it's the very ground building work. Like a parent looking adoringly at their baby, making eye contact. The baby looks back. They experience the mirroring that is love, and that helps develop the self in profound, constructive ways. It is the teaching of children about the safety of life, what it means to be safe in a place. It's about investigating the natural world, the world of wonders, and taking delight with a child or a youth or an adult about the wonder of it all. It is constructive and helps us appreciate and value the life that we have. So encourage one another and build each other up. This is Paul's intent for the Thessalonians. And it is essential, and it is mutual, and it is ministry. I want to talk about each of those. It's essential. This constructive work and this interventional work are absolutely essential if we are going to live lives that God intends. We need to be shaped and formed. We need to understand the wonder of living. And we need to be upheld and supported when we fall or when we become endangered. It is absolutely essential for us to experience this sort of constructive work. I think of Mark Twain, who writes, "I can live 3 months on one good compliment." 3 months. That is the constructive work of affirming each other, of saying to one another, "Well done, beautiful singing. Oh, that was so lovely on the piano." It is that sort of constructive work, that we are those who need that affirmation, that we flourish with that sort of affirmation. We need to learn, to grow. We need to find our understanding of the world, to construct a worldview and a perspective that enables us to understand the life that we have. We need skills to develop. We go to school or training. All of that is essential for our well-being. Our children need to develop in the faith. That's why we have church school, and that's why youth, we aspire to impart to them ideals and principles of life. We as adults continue to need to be inspired and grow in faith all our days. And we also need the advocacy work. We need to be upheld when we are grieving, to be comforted. We need to be supported when we feel weak. We need the kind of intervention that prayer is. Those who are advocating on our behalf to our gracious God. We need constructive and interventive work in our lives. And friends, it is essential now more than ever. Now, when we cannot hold one another in an embrace. Now, when we cannot reach out our hand and shake the hand of another or pat each other on the back, it is so hard. This disconnect that we are in right now for the sake of keeping each other safe. It leads people to feel lonely, depressed, anxious. Folks are becoming reclusive. We don't hear from them. The kind of mental health crisis that we're in because of COVID is just overwhelming to therapists and to others who seek to care for them. We need this interventive and constructive work now more than ever. So our work is essential. It's also mutual. It's not simply about Lynn and I and the elders and deacons kind of reaching out. It is something we all do. We all do with our eyes. We all do with our bodies. We do it with our sign language. We do this work for and with each other. It goes both ways. And it is work that has a character that we all are engaged in. I'm thinking of the beautiful quote that Mary Jane Dyke's son, Alex, loved to say to his mother and to all who would listen. Life is short. We don't have much time to gladden the hearts of those who walk this way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. All of us, be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And finally, friends, this is ministry. It is serving one another. It is serving that all those who believe and baptized receive a ministry, we say when we welcome new Christians into our life. We all share in this ministry. And it is a ministry that takes countless forms among us these days. I am so moved by the way in which I see it, the way in which I see you who are gathered here and you who are watching online. I see it constructively in the First Reformed Church pathways where children and families sort of carefully kind of go around from station to station and are and are instructed and are built up in the teachings of our faith, the goodness of creation, the parable of God's abundance. I'm seeing it in the Zoom chat rooms where people greet each other when folks come on the screen, when they say, "Hey, Ellie and Jean, how are you?" It's being seen and noticed. It is ministry of presence and recognition and acknowledgement. I see it in the Kerygma Bible study that gathers, where we continue to learn, and the Horizons study that people are exploring lament. I saw it in the anti-racist work, that more is coming, more work around continuing our journey. I saw it this morning with the ushers who are welcoming folks in, with Tom and Leanne and Dave graciously bringing us into the presence, with Dave's beautiful, beautiful kind of arrangement of pumpkins and squash and whatnot. This constructs a beauty of our life in all these ways and so many others. Youth group happening, stories on the steeple, the way in which our musicians bless us as we gather here. All these ways and more, we construct a world, a life together as a community that is a blessing. And it is ministry of intervention. Our COVID safety policy task force was doing a ministry of intervention, gathering and working together, exchanging ideas and seeking to construct a policy that would be safe for all God's people and everyone we come into contact with. I saw it at the consistory that works to set boundaries and guidelines that seeks to help us be together as a people amidst this crisis in a safe and productive way. I see it with our prayer chain ministry, which there's almost no day goes by without people asking for prayer and receiving prayer. It is the ministry of advocacy and intervention. I've seen it with our support and care committee that has said, here are all the people who are homebound or who may be lonely or feeling depressed. We will call those people. Every one of our support and care ministry folks do so. And I've seen it with the dinner and do good that combines both. Those young people share a time of fellowship together that constructs their life, and they go out and do good in the community, serving others who are in need, building one another up in love. This ministry in which you are engaged, more and more, is a ministry that is rooted, grounded in God's love for us. And it is realized in the self-giving of Jesus Christ, the one who encouraged, who supported, who comforted, who advocated for, and who built up his first disciples. And through the Holy Spirit, it flourishes in us in this day, in this time, in this place, in this world still, as the gifts of the Spirit are embodied and enacted among us for the well-being of one another, and the glory of God, and the life of the world. Therefore, brothers and sisters and others, keep doing what you're doing. Keep encouraging and comforting and supporting and advocating and building one another up in love and in faith and in hope. Amen.
With whatever has brought you here this morning, be it prayers of great joy and or prayers of concern, I invite you to bask for a moment in the hands of the Lord. It is an amazing thing, O God, that we come here seeking to touch you with the stuff of our lives and the stuff of our world. And you allow us to touch you, to touch awe, to touch wonder, to touch holiness. And you do this whether we have been coming to you every day of our lives or whether we have just dropped in today for the first time. You are here for us to encourage and support and advocate on our behalf. And we are amazed. And we thank you for all the ways you show that to us. Through our neighbors, through those who serve this church, through those who love us, through those who are our neighbors, crossing our path for the first time. We know that in these times you are there, in these times where the days grow shorter, where there is frost, where there is rain, that you are there in the wonders of vibrant colors and possibilities, making us aware of light and life and hope and grace. And so we know we can come to you in our needs, in our times of distress, whether we worry about our own health or the health of others, those who face surgery, those who are in rehab, those who grieve great loss, or in the things of this world that reach in and touch us, times of brutality, times where people are racialized, times when we are made aware of how many hungry children and women and men there are in this world. Times when the numbers of COVID grow greater and touches people we know, this disease, this silent disease. And we trust that you hold us in your precious hands. And we are grateful, O God, to know that it is you alone who can transform our needs. That it is you alone working through us and between us and among and within us that will make that happen. You who help us to step forward. You who help us to let go and move on. You who encourage us to step into the chaos of change and process, to offer ourselves and our skills. You who allow us to look forward to what is yet to come, because of what already is among us. And we ask you to hear us as we join our voices together to pray from the heart the words that Jesus gave to his friends to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, as we rise to sing, I invite you to remember how we are bound to those who have gone before. Let us keep in our hearts Dolph, Josephine, Albert, Richard, John, Richard, Gilbert, Earl, Jean, Norman, and Mary Jane among us. Let us sing together. Let us sing in our hearts while Kate sings on our behalf.
To that in our dismissal today, I believe the ushers are at the ready to help people be dismissed safely. So following the charge and the benediction, I'm guessing they're going to invite the first pews to go out first. They'll show you the way you should go. They'll shepherd you carefully, just so that we can keep each other as safe as we can be. And now hear these words. Go out into the world in Christ's peace. Give no person evil for evil. Hold fast to what is good. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Honor all people. And may the blessings of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer be with you now and always. Amen.